So we created an account. I signed out just to start from the beginning. Go back to the browser. I was in Google Chrome. You can go to anyone. I'm going to go to a different browser just to show you. It doesn't matter which one you use. I'll open another browser. And we want to go back to plus.google.com. We had to do those steps to go over to the business page and all of that, but to actually use it, plus.google.com. It's going to show you this stuff here, which changes every time you go to it. Top right corner. Well, we should hopefully now all have an account, so I'll click sign in on the top right corner. Sign in with the credentials that you just used a moment ago, your email and your password. So I've signed in with the email address that I've set up. In my case, I see this icon that I added. You don't see it by default. Yours is still probably a little blank person. But if you click your icon on the top right, I'm in my personal profile. And there's the brand account or the business page I created a moment ago. So that's what I want to do right away. Sign in and switch over to the brand page. Question? Want to switch over to the business page as soon as possible? Question?
So what's the difference here?
You might see a screen that says control, protect, and secure your account. That's like the settings of your whole Google account.
I know. How do I add the brand page under this account? Like, I have multiple accounts, So I want the brand page.
The personal profile is for personal things to share with friends and family. And the business account, the business page, the brand page is to use it for business purposes, for marketing your business. All right, so I'm still thinking about Google Plus in the old style. I've been on Google Plus since the beginning, so I still think about it in those terms that you would see a little person. I keep saying a blank person. Now they do initials. Sorry about that. Your initial that appears there shows that it's an account. There used to be a little face right there. But anyway, on the top right corner, whatever your initial was, when you click there, then you'll see the different pages if you created it the way we did a moment ago. So you want to then select your brand account. It looks almost exactly the same. Maybe it's a welcome to the new Google Plus. Well, great, let's go. We have these menu items very similar to the menu items a moment ago of my personal, but there's a couple of differences that we'll see. So we'll take a moment to look at the anatomy of a Google Plus account, then we'll start to use it. Using it will be similar to Twitter in that we want to share the various things that we talked about there, pictures or text or video, searching, all of those things. But let's get oriented to what we have here. In my case, it took me to collections first. Click on home. If you don't see that menu on the left side, you can open it and hide it with the main menu at the top left. I usually always have it open. But we've got these different sections, these different screens. The home screen here is like the home screen on any other social network. On Twitter, we had the home screen where we saw the tweets of all the accounts we're following. Here, we would see all of the posts of the accounts we're following. Facebook has a home screen, Pinterest has a home screen, Instagram has a home screen. They've all got a home screen where you see the content of what people are sharing. I haven't connected with anyone yet I see a lot of things. Well, notice these are perhaps marked as hot on Google Plus, or it's marked as trending on Google Plus. So because we just set it up, we don't really have any connections, so it's just going to show you rather random things that are hot on Google Plus. Maybe we care, maybe we don't. But here's where we would see the latest updates from the accounts that we have connected with. We have the button, What's New With You? That's a spot to write something. We'll get back to that in a moment. And we also see a little pencil, which is also to share or to post. We're using any of these networks to post something, to share something. A picture of our product, a link to a coupon, a question to our followers and fans, content. Whatever we talked about on Twitter last week applies here as well. And we'll see variations. Collections screen is one of Google Plus's newest features, which is sort of like folders. It sort of reminds me of Pinterest. I think this is Google Plus's way to then start to get on Pinterest's turf. Pinterest is made of pin boards. You have a collection of posts on Pinterest when we talk about Pinterest. They're called pins on Pinterest, and they're called boards, folders. Here are folders, here are collections. Holiday Cottage has created a folder, a collection about places to see in Brighton and Sussex. Randy T has created a collection called Favorite Photos While Climbing. So people or businesses can create collections. And at the moment, this is showing me the featured collections. All of the people on Google Plus, the hundreds of millions of people on Google Plus, those that have perhaps used collections and shared them, they're kind of being featured here. And yours is probably different than mine, and you know, if I were to leave the screen and come back, I get a whole new bunch of collections. The point of this, that we want to take advantage of later, is that I want to get featured here at some point. We'll see why and how later, but I'll make a note. Difference or uniqueness of Google Plus collections. Groups of content on a topic. Recommendation. You should create collections.
Mm-hmm.
anything that I do on this page in terms of following somebody or liking or whatever procedures there are, is that happening under my branded page?
Yes, that's why as soon as possible, when we log in, we want to switch to the brand.
So it will have no reference whatsoever to my personal page.
Exactly. If I stay on my personal, whoops, I'm doing business stuff on my personal. That's why as soon as you sign in, switch to the business brand. And there's no connection between the two. So these collections that I may create, one reason is to help me get found. I want traffic, I want visibility, I want fame on Google Plus, just like I want it on Twitter, just like I want it on Facebook, Pinterest, YouTube, all the networks. You're seeing here several times how Google Plus is pushing and promoting collections. You see that right away when I went to plus.google.com, here's some collections. You saw when I logged in, here's some collections. There's some algorithm, probably some trade secrets about how you get here, but it relates to popularity and the amount of content, and on many of these networks, popularity breeds popularity. As you're popular, your popularity will grow. You'll get more popular when you're popular. But I need to get popular before I become popular. It's a catch-22. So of course we talk about how to break that catch-22. But the more popular you are, the more popular you'll get. We'll get the ball rolling for that. But one idea is, what about creating collections? We'll see how and why soon. We're just going to do an overview for the moment. Make a note. I want to create collections eventually. They could help me get popular. Communities are related to collections in that they are groups of content. The big difference is that a collection is I create a collection and only I can post to that collection. Communities, I can create a community and other people can also post to it, contribute to it. Like the classic message boards or BBSs, a BBS of yore. So we can say here, collection, you create it, and only you contribute to it. Communities. You can create it, and anyone can contribute. You can control it and allow people and remove people and all of that. We'll get to that. But communities are more like classic where people congregate on a topic. I can create a community called Southern California Bakers. And hopefully then I attract people to that community. We'll see the pros and cons of that, but I'll also say here the recommendation is you should follow communities. Up here I said create. You should create your own collections. Down here, I'm not going to recommend for you to create your own communities. I'll see why later. But I'm going to say instead you should follow communities. Don't follow these yet until we go into detail about them. But two big selling points of Google Plus are collections and communities. Twitter doesn't have those. Facebook has groups, which are sort of like communities, but how many of you have heard of Facebook groups before? Not that many. How many of you have used Facebook groups before? A few people. How many of you have used Facebook groups in the last week? Not that many. So if you don't know about them, if you've never used them, don't worry. Facebook groups haven't really taken off like they were supposed to. We'll talk about them when we talk about Facebook. But groups, communities, collections where people congregate on a topic.
Is a community like a blog in a sense?
Not really. A blog is usually a long form sort of text where you contribute to it yourself, for yourself. Communities are where people can connect together, more like a traditional bulletin board system. We'll go into detail for both of them in a moment, but let's go then to profile. What did I say about profiles on Twitter? First thing you want to do. Early on, you want to set up your profile properly. Your graphic for your business, top pictures, that sort of thing. You'll do that at a later point because I already mentioned it for Twitter. But if you weren't here last week, you want to edit your profile and fill in your name and hours of operation and graphics and about information as soon as possible so that you don't look like any other fly-by-night spammer. Right now, I just have some generic circles and lines and colors. I need to have my graphic there of my products or my homepage or the storefront or happy customers or something, just like Twitter. I need to have my logo of my business, not just a generic T. I want the logo of my business. Because all of these others, like on collections, these are people. Far East of Russia by Alexander Antonov, there's his picture. Priya Adivarakadar, makeup and beauty and dance beats, there's her picture. The real people, real businesses have their real logos and such there, not just the generic blank icon. Perhaps that's one of the reasons they're also being featured. Other reasons we'll talk about later, but they have a complete profile, and at the beginning we don't. At some point you should go then through the edit profile.
Is there any easy way to make the logo?
Not quite. To make any of these graphics and such, you need a graphic software. Or a graphic designer, someone that knows how to do it. But the closest is you, I think I might have mentioned last week, you could use the free online photo editor, Pixlr.com. That might be a way for you to make a graphic or edit your pictures. But someone that knows how to do it will probably give you better results than Pixlr.com. So that profile at the moment is very sparse. It doesn't really look like a very good profile. Why would someone follow? Just like Twitter, just like Facebook when we get to it, just like Pinterest. Why am I going to follow an account that doesn't have a logo, doesn't have about information, doesn't have content? We're going to need to also post 3 to 5 things, just like we talked about Twitter, which we'll get to. That's the profile screen. Here's where you can also manage your collections. People, here are your connections. As you set up Google Plus, as you use it, it might start to suggest to you people to connect with. Those people may be potential customers. Right now it doesn't know anything about me really, so it can't suggest anything to me. But as I post to Google+, as I follow accounts, as I use it, it'll start to know, you seem to be an account about baked goods. Here are various people on Google+ that may be interested. So I can connect with them, I can follow them. We talked last week about the tactic. One way to start to build followers, one way to start to build popularity is for you to start to follow accounts, you to start to give and you'll get. You start to give, you start to follow accounts, some may follow you back.
For communities, do we join communities or follow communities?
You join a community. And we'll go into detail about the nuances of that soon. So you join a community. And here you would follow a person or a business. It'll list who you are currently following, so if you no longer want to follow an account, remember the purpose of following is I want to see everything that they're posting. I'm going to see it on my home screen. If I've chosen to follow 10 accounts, I'm going to see their stuff on my home screen. And I realize I actually don't want to see the messages of that particular account. I don't want to follow them anymore. So I can see on my following screen who I'm following, and I can click on follow. People get a notification when you follow them. But people don't get notified when you unfollow them. That also happens on Twitter. A differentiator here is that I can organize people into circles. On Twitter, I can follow 100 people. And so can I here on Google+, any network. But what's better on Google Plus is then I can put people into circles, and I can create circles to organize them. Let's say I'm a pet shop, and I'm going to sell cat food. This week, I'm going to have a sale on cat food. I want to target the cat owners of my followers. So if I have organized my connections into cat people, dog people, bird people, I can target my posts just to those people that are more apt to be interested and buy the product. We'll see how to follow and how to organize in circles soon. Yes? No, I just chose a number.
Oh.
I just chose a number. There's no maximum. Let's say I had 100 that I was following, but there's no max. I think maybe like 100,000 or something, but for all intents and purposes. Mm-hmm. And then who has followed you, your followers? Sometimes people might right away get one follower. Who's this person? Well, spam bots are around sometimes, and they're scanning for who's a new person. So if you get a brand new follower, then you haven't really shared anything, you might ignore it, or you might click here on the followers and block them. I don't spend too much time blocking accounts that follow unless they're being annoying or harassing. If they're following my business but they don't have anything to do with the business, I'll just ignore it, because there is some value to seeing I've got 10 followers as opposed to I've got one follower. Popularity breeds popularity, as I said. So if your business page has very few followers, other people will say, why would I follow? No one else is following. But if you've built up some followers, 10, 12, 50, whatever, people will say, okay, well, there's some people following them. They might have some value. I'll follow. Events is complex for us at the moment. I'm going to skip that for the moment. I'll go back. But events are a way to create these events, these virtual meetings. You can set that next Saturday, 1 p.m., everyone join me at, you know, 1 p.m. Pacific time. We'll all chat together, share photos. We'll have an event. Twitter doesn't have that. Facebook does. Other networks have some variation. It's too complex to talk about it at the moment. But that's one of the ways to build an audience, to keep an audience. It's a lot of work, though.
But it happens online. It's not
online. Mm-hmm. You could set it up to be a physical location also, meet up, but that's obviously even more work. If you've got like a web camera plugged in and such, you could do a virtual